Hey everyone, we're back with another grinding video, or the same grinding video, but I've got a more knowledgeable guest with me this time.
Hi, it's JamieTheD.
And he's gonna actually tell us about some of the folks that we've been meeting in Chapter 4.
Yep, I suppose we want to start with Thrumpin.
Alright.
Yeah, the Thrumpin is an interesting one, because the only reference to it that I've been able to find is in one Scottish poem in a folklore book. And that was the Notes on the Folklore of the Northern Counties of England and the Borders.
Is there, like, any funny stereotypes about the North, or is that just kind of an interesting tidbit?
Well, mostly it's a folklore book. It seems to have been written early 20th. And the thing is, like many early folklore books, it kind of stretches things a bit. As I said, the only reference to the thing I could find is in this poem. And that poem, it sounds more like an onomatopoeia. Let's see, the two places it's mentioned are when the Ellery del Clumprin, when the Teorie's hard doth thrumpen, and later in the poem, when the hawky bird he kisses the yid, then there's the time for thrumpen. Which sounds to me like an onomatopoeia for basically walloping someone. But if you believe this Northern folklore book, they're a kind of sprite who were the reverse of guardian angels. They could basically kill people.
So not the kind that hangs out on your shoulder and gives you bad ideas.
No, just outright kills you.
Hey, you know it'd be really great. You jumped off that bridge. It'd be a thrill.
Well, speaking of sirens, we've got the, I'm going to apologize in advance for all the pronunciation mistakes I'm going to make. Leodag, which is a Scottish ogre. It supposedly hung around in lakes on the Isle of Skye. And, apart from that, it fulfilled a purpose very similar to Grendel in Beowulf and pretty much any ogre ever. It hung around, it got very grumpy, it preferred to be on its own, and if you pissed it off, it would rip your arms off. Another nice simple one.
Yeah, sounds like it. I mean, as long as anyone's familiar with Beowulf.
Well, yeah. Then, of course, you got ones which we might as well get the ones which aren't, don't appear to be anything out of the way. For example, the Garbra might be a reference to a place called Gavir, where the Fianna, led by, of course, Finn McCool, who is the best Irish hero, were finally beaten. Or it might refer to a flower called the Gerbera.
Well, I think if we're going to stretch it that far, it might be a reference to baby food.
Yeah, it could be at that. After all, we also have the candela, which, isn't that the SI unit of illumination?
I believe so.
Yeah, and of course the Humpty, which, if I recall, actually did look vaguely egg-like. And,
well, we're looking at candela now. They're pretty much identical.
Yeah, but Humpty is, of course, a reference to Humpty Dumpty, which may have started its life as a riddle. Either way, most well-known from Lewis Carroll's Alice Wonderland.
If it was a riddle, what the heck would the answer be?
Well, apparently it had an earlier form from the 14th century, which was some sort of riddle. Although I cannot find the text of said riddle, which is annoying.
It was probably an egg.
Well, yeah. The Brolochan, though. Now, that's an interesting one. B because there's no description of the Brolochan itself. There's only a description of what it grew into, which is a foith. It's a Scottish Gaelic water spirit. It's supposedly terrifying in looks, but on the other hand, loves intercourse, social or sexual, with humans. For example, the Munros of Scotland claim foith blood. So make of that what you will. They're either male or female, and they're incredibly hard to catch. There's a myth of one hunter who supposedly managed to tie up a foith and told his mates about it. They went back to where he tied up the foith, and guess what was there?
Just empty ropes?
A jellyfish in the middle of a field.
Oh, well, I never would have seen that coming.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's a very weird thing with myth. You always have these terrifying creatures that nonetheless like to just chat or bang humans. I mean, you've got harpies, sirens, who were basically harpies. And of course, hags. Not quite sure what's going on there.
I don't know, I always took hags to be more dangerous than that.
Depends on the hag. For example, Baba Yaga was very capricious. Either she would fuck you up, or she'd give you something to help you. It depends. Russian myths are not very reliable in terms of safety. But then you've got the habitrot, which is supposedly a beautiful woman a spinner fairy, which has 7 ugly slaves. And the 7 ugly slaves are the interesting part, because the habitrot, along with its slaves, spins clothing that supposedly either makes you never ill or heals your wounds. It also blesses people with the ability to weave. However, there's a catch there, as One Tail quite thoroughly points out. A young lady who was quite lazy was given the gift of sewing by Habitrot after her parents asked them, because, well, she was lazy and she wasn't much of a wife for anyone. However, the husband years later came across the same Habitrot who was there with her 7 ugly slaves and basically said, "Well, you see these slaves? Your wife's such a good spinner, I'm really thinking of taking her on." And so the husband came back and told his wife never to work again. It's Gaelic, so Irish, Irish-Scottish in origin. And, it's a bit of a weird one, like many fae.
Yeah, but that does explain why there are 8 habitrot in the game. You know, 7 fakes and the real one.
Well, the 7 aren't so much fakes as, well, you could say they're part of the same manifestation. Speaking of manifestations, what do you know about psychopomps?
Well, before you told me what they were last time we talked, nothing, apparently.
Well, psychopomps, they're basically spirits or some kind of creature that heralds death. And occasionally brings it on. It depends on the psychopomp.
Yeah, that's coming up in the video in a couple minutes.
Oh, good. Well, might as well talk about it, though. It's the Skriker, which is often confused with another infamous British myth, the Black Dogs. Actually, that one's not just a British myth. It's also a Breton myth. Black dogs feature quite prominently in British myth. But the Skriker acts like any other psychopomp. It looks like a black dog. Black dogs, by the way, not your average dog. I mean, your average dog is at most about 4 or 5 foot tall, yeah?
No. At least not any of the dogs I've known.
Okay, sorry. 3 foot.
Still a bit bigger than most dogs of my acquaintance.
Yeah, there are some dogs that are 3 to 4 foot tall that I'm aware of. But anyway, yes, black dogs, bigger. Bigger, nastier, generally with red eyes. Doesn't matter whether it's red, yellow. Either way, glowing eyes, very unsettling. And people, there are lots of different origins for black dogs. Sometimes, like the Skriker, they're basically psychopomps or dogs of ill omen. Later Christianization would have them being ghosts of sinners or associated with the devil, which of course itself was a conflation of several myths itself. So yeah, that's the Skriker. It's a big old mess.
Oh, okay, yeah, I was gonna say the only black dog I know is the one that escaped from wizard prison. Another Harry Potter reference.
Yep. Harry Potter? Okay, series. Anyway, yes. Spriggans are another good one, because, Spriggans used to be giants. Then they were the ghosts of giants. And then the fair folk found them. The fair folk managed to turn them into essentially bodyguards and security for their meeting places. Don't ask how, it just happened over time as a corruption of myth. Spriggans are interesting because they have the ability, funnily enough, one of the few places where D&D gets things right, to basically become larger. Much larger. But despite this, they're actually pretty mellow. They prefer to just scare people or, you know, lightly beat them up for trespassing, as opposed to actually killing them, which some fairy creatures do.
It seems like there's a whole lot of death in myth.
Oh god, yes. Death, sex, all sorts. And swords. Yeah. The Answerer. Have we got any Answerers here?
We just finished building that up a few minutes ago before I started this epic quest to defeat Kushi with Candela.
Yes. Kushi. That's one of the repeats, if I recall, is it not?
Kushi was the last chapter.
Yeah. Well, yeah, Answerer. If you just look for Answerer, you're obviously not going to find anything. Instead, you should look for its Irish name. Fragrach. Again, apologies for my pronunciation. It was called the Answerer because so long as the tip of the sword was held at someone's throat, they literally couldn't lie. And we're talking above and beyond, you know, not having the desire to lie with a sword at your throat. So this was originally a weapon of the sea god of Ireland, Mananan MacLir. It had wind control powers, which sort of makes sense. And apparently it was able to cut through walls and leave piercing wounds in enemies that they could never recover from, which, again, is a very common thread with Irish mythical weapons.
Yeah, it sounds kind of familiar.
Yeah, well, it would sound kind of familiar because I believe previously Red Rover discussed Lugh. Lugh, the first High King of Ireland.
Yeah, I think so.
Who's often considered to be a sun deity. Mythology's a bit of a mess. Partly because of Christianization, partly because, of course, lack of documentary sources, partly, of course, because myths evolve over time. Good example, Little Red Riding Hood. Little Red Riding Hood actually started out as a French fable. And in one of the earliest versions of the story, Little Red Riding Hood actually, at the request of the wolf, who was posing as her grandmother, asked Little Red Riding Hood to get naked and get into bed, and she was eaten alive. Double entendre fully intended.
Well, I kind of thought you were going with the one where the woodcutter opened up the wolf's stomach and put rocks in.
That's a good one. That's a good one. But as you can see, there's lots of different versions of myths. So sometimes Lugh is considered a sun deity, sometimes he is just the first High King of Ireland, which honestly is a pretty big deal.
It sounds like an impressive title.
Yeah, now, the thing is, the High King of Ireland was basically an elected king. From a small pool of nobles, but elected. And there were actually a lot of rules about who could become High King and who couldn't. For example, if a noble was considered unjust in any way, nope, can't be High King. And they actually had a class of, a caste of people specifically for adjudicating this sort of thing, the Brehon, who were basically the equivalent of judges in Irish society.
Well, it's good to know they had checks and balances even back then.
Oh god, yes. So, yeah, that's pretty much most of Ellen's stuff. Excepting, of course, the Mabinogion. I think we're going to save that one for last for reasons.
Okay, yeah, I'm done killing them. Peg Powler's been built up enough.
So why don't we have a quick chat about the two folks introduced in Keats's.
Alright.
Chapter 4. The Galley Beggar. Again, very simple. It's very similar to Bloody Bones, the Boogie Boy in Wales, and a lot of other skeletal, ghostly figures, in that its whole purpose is to scare the shit out of folks. That's it. Doesn't kill anyone. Doesn't steal anything. Doesn't, you know, you don't leave a bowl of milk out for it. Nope. It's a skeleton whose head is under its arm. It screams, freeze folks, paralyze people, basically, and it hangs around in Somerset. So there's another reason not to go to Somerset.
Like we needed another one?
Well, it's got nice scenery, so, you know. And finally, there's the Padfoot, which is actually kind of close to how it looks in the game. Because there are two possible descriptions of the Padfoot, which is another psychopomp or herald of death, this time from Yorkshire, which is one of my favourite places. Supposedly, it's either a big white dog, and just like black dogs, we have white dogs, and those have a huge mess of things going along with them. Some white dogs are actually black dogs. Blah, 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 blah. Or it's a shaggy ball with eyes.
And no feet.
No, well, feet, it's... Some say it's got 1 foot, some say it's got 3 feet. It's a bit confused. But either way, it was about the size of a donkey. It could become invisible at will. And it literally roared and rattled to scare folks away. And apparently, if you even touched it, it had some form of power over you. Although, what sort of power that was is ill-defined.
The power to make sure you couldn't live to tell anyone else about it.
Let's not go into why that's probably not it.
Well, you know, otherwise you'd expect to have some record of it.
Well, yeah, but records can be untrustworthy. Which is a really good segue into the Mabinogion.
Alright. As long as we establish that Padfoot is not actually connected to the Black Dog in any way. Except
no.
For that really tenuous black-is-white connection you mentioned.
Yeah. Yeah, there are lots of tenuous connections in mythology. Yeah, the Mabinogion is a book. In fact, it's 4 books and then a load of other stories. And it is the central Welsh myth cycle. Screw Arthurian myth. Screw, a lot of other myth. Nope. The Mabinogion is the Welsh myth cycle. It came from 2 written sources, because previous to Christianization, we only had an oral history, and this ended up biting us in the arse, mythology-wise. Why'd it bite us in the arse? Because the only written form of our myths were post-Christianization, and have been translated pretty badly ever since. So the Mabinogion comes in 4 branches, to do with 4 family lines. The branch of Pwyll, the branch of Branwen, the branch of Math, and the branch of his nephew, Mathonwy. Each of them have all sorts of fun stuff. For example, the branch Math has a hero who is possibly harder to kill than Achilles.
Of course, Achilles had that giant weakness.
Well, Achilles had one weakness. Hlaeclawgufus had a much weirder weakness. And it was his only weakness. He could only be killed by being stabbed in the side with a spear with hawthorn wrapped around it while he's lying in a half-filled bath with 1 foot on the ground and 1 foot on the back of a doe.
Oh, now come on. That happens all the time. I think I did that 3 times just this past week.
I know, but, how do we know this? Because, as is common in myth, his wife tried to kill him. His wife was actually made by his father, Math, out of flowers. Her name was Blodwedd, which means woman of flowers. And, she fell in love with another man. And they plotted to kill Hlaeclawgufus. It didn't work. She got the method of killing him out of him by pretending to be a concerned wife. But it didn't work, and he turned into a sparrow. flew away, almost lost his mind to the shape-changing. Common thread in shape-changing myth is that when you shape-change, your mind has a risk of becoming like the animal.
I would have loved to be part of that planning meeting, though.
Yeah, tell me about it.
Okay, so we figured out how to get the doe there, but how do we get him to put his foot on it and the other foot on the ground?
Well, this is where Tleitlau Guffus proves that he's not the smartest of people. Because not only does he tell her, oh, this is how you kill me, she then says, well, why don't we have a test run to make sure I know exactly what to avoid?
Darwinism was too late in coming.
Yeah. But eventually, his father Math found him. Tleitlau Guffus told the whole story, probably quite embarrassed. And Math got understandably rather pissed. And turned Blodiwedd into an owl. And hence, the owl is a very unlucky animal in Welsh myth. So that's just one of the myths in the Mabinogion.
So how many of them actually involve people turning into birds? Because it sounds like a pretty common thread here.
Birds, not many. There's a Christian monk who turns his wife into a mouse as part of an elaborate plan. There's the punishment of two guys who used illusions and conjuring to get into the bed of a guy called Gwydion's wife while he was away at war, which was itself an illusion. Those guys got a cruel and unusual punishment. They were turned into a female doe and... well, a doe and a deer. And they would live among the wild, they would be despised by all the other animals, and their only solace would be in each other. That would be for a year. So, they mated, they had a kid, and Gwydion turned the kid into an actual kid. Then turned them into a sow and a pig. A year went by, they had another kid, and this goes on for about 3 more animals. So, pro tip, don't bang somebody's wife in Wales.
I certainly wasn't planning on it.
Yeah. But, of course... as I mentioned, this is post-Christianization, so there's a lot of confusion as to whether the characters in the Mabinogion are gods, or demigods, or heroes, or just, you know, your average good Christian folk. It's kind of on a case-by-case basis, because magic, as you might have guessed, is incredibly common. For example, the brother of Branwen, the main character of the branch of Branwen, is a giant, quite literally a giant. There are 2 big clues that he's a giant. One, that he has to sleep outside. He's too big for all the houses. And 2, when he eventually invades Ireland, long story... the Irish lookout who first spots him doesn't realise it's a bloke walking across the Irish Sea, along with a fleet of ships. He thinks it's a forest, with a chasm above it, a mountain above that, and 2 lakes to either side.
Because that crosses the Irish Sea all the time.
Well, considering Celtic Gaelic myth, stranger things have happened.
I'm beginning to get that impression.
Yeah. So, do you class that guy as a god, a spirit, a normal Christian dude. I somehow think the normal Christian dude is a bit unlikely.
I don't know, I've seen some pretty tall people.
Yeah, this is true. But, and then of course there's translation. One particular bugbear of mine, I've posted this already in the thread, but I'm gonna say it again, is a place called Anun. Anun is another place where magic happens. There are two kings of Anun, or at least there are at the beginning of the Mabinogion. King Aron and King Hafgar. Now, King Aron had a problem in that he wanted to rule the whole shebang, but King Hafgar could only be killed on the first blow. You give him a mortal wound and then you finish him off out of mercy, he's back the next day, large as life. So he gets King Pwyll to take his place, and because Pwyll is basically a nicer person than Aron, doesn't actually finish Hafgar off at the early duel. Mortal wound, Pwyll basically says, "No, I think you can get better from that," and Hafgar says, basically dies. That is one of the few stories of Anun in the Mabinogion, in our Welsh myth in general. And people take this and the fact that it's one of the supposed homes of the Cauldron of Plenty of Irish myth to mean that it's a fairy land or a land of the dead, on the flimsiest of evidence. Now, we Welsh, we're very literal. A good example, the longest place name in Wales. Do you know what it translates to?
I don't have a clue.
It's a description of surrounding landmarks. That's it. It's something like the church on the valley, over the hill, down from the quarry, or something like that. We're a literal people. So, if it had been a land of the fairies or a land of the dead, it would have been something like Tir Mabu. Or, I can't remember which one it was for death, but, yeah, it would have begun with Tir, and there we go. But no. Anun. And in fact, synonyms for this include Anhun, we'll get to that in a second, Ufern, which, as far as I'm aware, is a place in Wales. So, yeah, good job on that one. And, yeah, there's a couple of others, but either way, it's a word that doesn't make sense. So let's go back to Anhun. Anhun is, we use an as a privative prefix, something to say that something doesn't exist, like anhusfred, inflammable. And hun, well, we use that to mean this or that, but we also use it in place of umma, which means here. So put them together and what do you got?
Anywhere but here?
Pretty much. Just not here. There we go. That's the mystery of the supposed land the fairies solved. But there is a good reason why these are so badly translated, apart from the fact that a lot of the translations were by the English. We only have literally two books from which all these myths are written down. Two. Now, let me find which books they were, because I did not write it down, foolishly. Yes, it was the White Book of Rhedderch, or Llyfr Gwyn Rhedderch, written around 1350, and the Red Book of Hergest, or Llyfr Coch Hergest, written somewhere between 1380 and 1410. Those are our main sources for Welsh myth. And as you might imagine, for such old books, they weren't in very great condition when they were found. And this is the problem with a lot of myth. That a lot of it is oral history. You have to account for things like Christianization, or in Eastern myth, you have to account for, you know, the different governments, all that sort of stuff. You have to account for translation errors. And, of course, you have to account for things like the Thrumpin, where the only source is highly dubious.
Well, I kind of gather that for this game they were drawing from any source they could find.
Actually, it seems to be predominantly Gaelic and Celtic, which is pretty cool, actually, because Folklore is set in Ireland, which is a Gaelic country. In fact, it's the Gaelic country. And nice slow-mo there.
Yeah, well, you know, you saw how many gargantua I had to kill to get green quartz, and I got it from the second spriggan.
You know
what's worse? I'll give you a preview of Chapter 5 here. One of the quests, the spriggan is the last thing that I kill, and guess what happens?
Oh! Oh dear. Yeah, so fairy spirits are the worst ones for this. We're going to be talking about boggarts in Chapter 5. And we've already talked about brownies. But there's a lot of interrelation between various creatures. Kobolds, brownies, pookas, spriggans, they're all in some fashion related, and at least one folklorist has basically said they're the same thing. So, for anyone who thinks either me or Red Rover did a bad job, this is what we gotta work with.
Well, I wouldn't say that either of you have done a bad job. This has been fascinating, and I'm looking forward to the next couple chapters.
Aye, well, it's been fun to be here.
Well, thanks again for doing the research and guesting in the video, and I hope to have you back in the next chapter.
Definitely be there.